Fear Effect is a series I have a few vague memories of, mainly of the second game. My grandmother played both of the PS1 games over 20 years back, the second first and then this original game, which I remembered absolutely nothing of. I rebought them both a couple years ago thanks to the recent-ish Fear Effect Sedna constantly being on sale on the eShop reminding me of the franchise's existence, around the time I decided to start up this channel. It got the memory stirring and I was interested in going back to remind myself of what it was all about. Then it took me 5 years total to buy and then get around to playing it. The game is set in the year 2050, after the disappearance of Wee Ming Lam, a Hong Kong triad boss's daughter. Three mercenaries, our playable characters, have been sent to find her with the intent to kidnap her before she can be saved, so that they can ransom her against her wealthy father. First thing they have to do is set the difficulty to hard, as it's the only way to obtain the true ending. This in turn will lead to me being a bit more forgiving towards some of the more frustrating parts, since I have chosen to make the game harder than intended for a new player. Starting a new game shows the mercenaries arrive at Hong Kong by some kind of small jet. Wee Ming narrates the opening, saying that the man that hired them to kidnap her instead of save her once worked for her father. Two of the mercenaries are in the plane, Hannah Tsu-vachel and Royce Glass. They talk about whether or not they can trust the man who hired them, Jin, who Hannah believes to be reliable. Jin helped Hannah get off the streets when she was younger and before he started working with the triads. Glass isn't so sure, considering the sheer amount of money at stake, if it even is as much money as he's thinking, which Hannah reassures him it is, considering Wee Ming's father is the most powerful triad leader in Hong Kong. They arrive at the Lam building, but Hannah is confused as Jin said he would be waiting for them on the helipad. She leaves Glass behind as she goes to look for him, and then I gain control. The game uses tank controls and has me playing on a series of pre-rendered backgrounds and FMV screens, which is the culprit behind the game being 4 discs, despite not being that long. I start with a pistol, a knife, and a mobile phone. I run around the helipad to find a switch that elevates it. Hannah gets off and Glass stays as it goes back down. I now have to walk along these catwalks. On the third screen is a pair of gunmen. I knife one in the arse, but they were aware of me and they gun me down. Well, that's a good start. On retry on the helipad, I find a save point, marked by the sound of the ringing phone as I pass by. This is what the phone is for, as I have to use it at these places to save. This time I do better at stealth by crouch walking, letting me instantly kill an enemy from behind with a knife when a red target appears at the top of the screen. Most enemies when killed drop some kind of ammo. While killing the second one, I cross over into a screen in front of a small room with a ladder on it. I can look through the window to see a lever I need to pull inside. I smash the window with my knife and climb in. I pull the lever, which releases a valve elsewhere. In the back of the room, I can take a fuse off a shelf. I go back outside and get climbing that ladder. There's another ladder going back down near a guard further on. The valve I release is up here, and I pull it to steam the gunman ahead to death. I climb down the second ladder and find the gunman is left behind a gate key, the gate it unlocks being right ahead. I crouch walk further to find 2 more gunmen to slash across the arse, one of which dropping a red keycard. Around the corner is the door the keycard is for. The guard in here somehow didn't hear me unlock the door and come in, so I can sneak behind him and kill him too. This is the security room, and I can check the cameras to see that Jin's betrayal was discovered and he's being interrogated somewhere in the building. We can see him dropping a key when he gets knocked over, while Hannah complains that Jin's claim of their deal being clean was a lie. I go through the exit next to the cameras. I move along the next catwalk, past the sign access to take out the next guard. But the one ahead hears it and becomes aware. I couldn't stealth kill him, so he gets a couple shots in on me before I cut him to death. My health is represented by the EKG meter at the top left of the screen. This gunman dropped a machine pistol, and I keep moving along the catwalk. This takes me to a switched off electrical grid with 3 guards on screen that I can't sneak up on due to the placement of the furthest left one, so it's a firefight. A firefight where I accidentally cancel the item menu instead of equipping the gun and get wiped out in seconds. I haven't saved since the first screen either, since I miss a save point on the way. The save point is on the desk in the security room. I get back and manage to shoot the first guy through a solid wall, but a 4th joins in right after. A green target at the top of the screen indicates I'm aiming my gun at an enemy. I get shooting a second, but get killed quickly. On my 3rd attempt I take out 3 of them, but a 5th one gets involved and I still die. It's not until my 5th try that I get it. This time, I start by shooting down the middle one and then retreating a screen. I run back in and take out my usual 1st target where no one can hit me and retreating again. My machine pistol ran out of ammo so the 3rd one has to be taken out by a regular pistol. Then I trigger the next 2's entrances so I can shoot them before they get the chance to act. I move on to the next screen and follow the catwalk inside where I find my next save point. I walk down the ramp here to see 2 guards ahead. I shoot one, but they both turn around and kill me. So I play smarter and go back to stealth to get rid of them. Heading towards the corner of the next screen is a fuse box. So I slot in the fuse I got back at the start, which reactivates the grid and cooks a 2nd set of guards that were sent there. It also unlocks a lift I walked past earlier. I inspect the corridor next to the fuse box, but get gunned down by the guard waiting for me. After reloading, I discover there is a locker key in the corner of the room I'd saved in. I kill the guard, but there's nothing else to do here, so I backtrack. Back at the grid, I have an issue. With it running again, the floor is electrified. Good news is that panels will temporarily switch off on a pattern that will give me a small window of time to cross. Bad news is I'm bad at tank controls and have to watch Hannah get electrocuted to death a couple times. I make it through on my third try though. I backtrack all the way to the security room and use the locker key on the locker there to get myself the blue key card and a second pistol. Now I have the option of using either just one pistol or two at once. The lift I activated is on this screen on the catwalk between the security room and the electrical grid. I take the lift down to the lower grid. Next to the fans is a set of wire cutters I take. I then head right and go inside and along the corridors, through the guards until I reach a save point and the door requiring the blue keycard. Jin is behind that door, having been rigged to a timed bomb, trying to make him talk before he paints the walls. Hannah interrupts, and the main grunt with the machine gun sets the others onto her while he runs off. I have to avoid shooting Jin and setting off the bomb, which is easy enough when I can shoot two enemies at once with dual pistols. I then take out the last one and cut Jin's arms free while Hannah asks what went wrong. Jin believes Lam didn't trust him and had him watched. I now have to deal with the bomb using the wire cutters I picked up. While they talk, we get mentioned that the third mercenary, Deke, is waiting in a hotel. Hannah asks who else knows of Weeming's disappearance outside the Triad, and Jin tells her that it's just her group. After they discuss how much money she's worth and how it's shared out, Hannah ends up setting off the bomb's timer while trying to work out how to disarm it. I have 6 minutes, and after slowly walking around the room picking up all the ammo, I use the wire cutters to get started. The correct order to cutting the wires is the right red wire, the left yellow wire, the right yellow wire, the left red wire, the right blue wire, the left blue wire, the bottom blue wire, the bottom yellow wire, and then the bottom red wire. Hannah decides to keep the bomb for later, and while Jin tries to change his fee, Hannah just demands the package he promised, a flash disk with all known information on Weeming. It includes the best place to start looking for her, and is hidden in the control panel near the building's neon sign. The key to it was taken by the grunt who ran off. Hannah tells Jin to go into hiding. Jin says he thought he was going to die, and then immediately gets gunned through the window to his death. That guy with the machine gun is the culprit, and he runs off again through the same door. So, was he just hanging outside that door all along, giggling to himself, waiting for the right time? Either way, he manages to escape by taking the lift I used to get down here. First time I passed through here, I ran past a door next to a chain link fence. I plant the bomb I took from Jin onto that door and blow it open. Running through it takes me back to the area where I fixed up the fuse box for the upper grid. When I end up back up there, it looks like someone's turned it off again, thankfully. The catwalks have been refilled with grunts as I backtrack to the sign access ladder next to the security room. Down the ladder and saving, I have to sneak out the door to take out the guards under the sign. I go through the entrance at the end of the catwalk to confront the gunman who killed Jin. His health is represented by the 6 bullets on the top right of the screen. I try just standing there and using my double pistols, but that only takes out 2 sections of his health bar before he kills me. Next, I try my unused until now dodge roll. I roll behind cover, roll out to get some shots in, and then roll back behind cover. It works fine until he gets moving again. Since there are a lot of buttons in use at once combined with the tank controls and the stressful situation, it's easy for me to make a mistake. I take 2/3 of his health but keep messing up my dodge roll alignments and get killed. Third try is my worst yet as I trap myself in a corner against him and barely damage him. Fourth try, I damage him even less. Skip to my 6th try and it's 2/3 taken again before he gets me. But on my 7th try, everything just works out. I get the alignments right for my dodging and manage to take him down with minimal damage. He drops a sign key and a second machine pistol so I can dual wield those as well. I use a sign key on the panel and have to match up the characters to the order they are on the sign outside. I can't read them to know what they say or how they're pronounced, but it's that. That is the correct order. The panel opens up and Hannah takes a flash disk. But she gets a gun pointed to her head. Meanwhile, Glass is getting impatient. He smoked a whole 1 cig and he's getting bored, so he's going to go look for Hannah. I go over to the lift I took at the start of the game, but before Glass can get it moving, a vehicle, a roto ship, flies up and missiles our own. It also knocks down a panel revealing a new ladder. I have to avoid missile fire and climb up it. It still takes me to the same catwalks I crossed with Hannah, but this time they're crawling with SWAT guys. And Glass is left with just the base weapon since he hasn't had a whole gameplay section picking stuff up before this. No stealth here, just have to keep shooting. I have to climb the ladder on top of the level room again, but this time I'm crossing it while avoiding copter gunfire. The room is blown up so I can't go back, and the copter retreats. The explosion gave me a safe place at least. I pick up a pipe from the rubble and use it on this nearby steam valve, getting Glass steamed in the face. Instead, I whack it with his melee weapon, the smackjack, which makes it explode. But I think I'm in a cutscene and just stand there, letting Glass die in the explosion. Next time I take 3 slow steps back, which makes it perfectly safe. I take a look in the resulting hole, only for the entire catwalk to collapse underneath him. Glass manages to grab something on the way down, but loses his grip and falls further. The sound of his fall distracts the gunman escorting Hannah, and she takes a chance to knee him in the balls and make him drop his knife. I take it back and get in a damage race with the guy's gun, winning and gaining an assault rifle for my victory. Time to sneak out from under the sign once again. But I alert the guards and get killed. Next time I get killed by the guy with the rifle. Third try I ignore stealth and run out there shooting, which works. I go back to the sign access ladder, but when I try to climb it, a door opens to reveal Mr. Lam, Wee Ming's father. He tells Hannah that she's made 2 mistakes. The first is not realising that he has enough resources to find his daughter himself. The second is that she didn't kill him before he could talk this long. And so Hannah gets captured again, and everyone forms a big pile to get some punches in on her. Meanwhile, Glass wakes up on top of this huge set of pipes. Different sections of pipes will heat up and cool down in a pattern, like the electrical grid earlier. Unlike the grid, touching hot pipe is not an instant death, though it's pretty close to one. I hang along the left pipes to find a valve I turn. I assumed I turned off the heat, so I got cocky and died from slowly walking back along it. Next time after turning the valve, I get back and run along the right hand pipes, stopping near the end for the safe space. I get all the way to the end and get back outside, where the roto ship returns for me. I don't know how to deal with it at first and get killed. I run to the top left of this area, wait for it to fly in front of this flag and shoot the flag off, getting caught in the engine and slowing it down. I then run to the right side and do the same, bringing the roto ship down, smashing a window before it explodes. Glass climbs through the window and ends up in the room Hannah found Jin. I take out the enemies and go through the door back to the lower grid. I sneak back through the corridors, stealth killing all the SWAT guys and getting an assault rifle before going through the door Hannah blew open. I stealth kill the first guy through here. I step forward and there are 3 men aiming at me, so I panic and go nuts with the rifle, taking 2 out before the third gets me. Second try goes worse, as I only kill 1 before I go down, with a 4th joining in. Rather than stealth kill, I hang in the doorway and just shoot from there. It doesn't work that great, since in that exact spot, it's somehow impossible to shoot the enemies on the left of the screen, so I die again. 4th try I try rolling around the screen, but forget to change to a gun when I need to shoot and get wiped out again. 5th try and I get it. I crouch in this exact spot, shoot when I can, and inch myself further when needed. The rest of the enemies form a single file line and make it easy for me to shoot them all down. Sadly, when I go up the ramp and I'm so close to saving, I run out of bullets on the last guy in there and get killed again. It's not until my 7th attempt that I get back and empty that room too and can finally save. I run past the upper grid and get killed on the catwalk. I get past on my 2nd try and return to the sign access ladder. As I go down it, Lam tells Hannah that the disc Jin made is encrypted and demands a code. But Hannah never knew of a code. In that case, Lam gives his men permission to shoot her, only for Glass to show up on time and shoot most of them out, one of them escaping with Lam. He hands Hannah a gun and leaves her to deal with another roto ship while he shoots at the grunts in the back. To fight the gunship, I have to wait for it to leave itself exposed, then roll out from behind the wall and get shooting before rolling back in to avoid gunfire. Glass will drop some ammo for me, but it's right next to him so I have to go out of my way to get it. I end up taking half of its life before it kills me. Second try, it goes really well until I get it down to the tiny sliver and then don't realise I'm out of ammo until I'm standing there exposed. Trying to roll neatly into the ammo so I can pick it up doesn't go well and I get killed again. But I get it on the 3rd try. With the gunman shot down, Hannah jumps over and kills the pilot, taking the roto ship. But Glass still needs to escape too, so I have to run towards a screen over this FMV of the pursuing SWAT team until I reach Hannah at the end and jump aboard. Hannah then takes off, and Glass tells her to go to the hotel so they can meet Deke and tell him about what's coming up. Deke, real name Jacob Descartes, receives a package with some sort of needle inside. He gets picked up by Hannah and Glass in a limo, who fill him in on what happened. Deke assumes they're abandoning the mission, but Hannah says that now they need Wee Ming as leverage for a safe exit from China. Deke points out that he only signed on for the money, and Glass says they can still get it, but they just need to find Wee Ming before anyone else. Deke is convinced and pulls out the decryption spike, the needle-like thing he got at the hotel, and Hannah uses it to get the disc working and finds a warning on it.
Only those deemed worthy will be spared. If Wee Ming is not back among us on the 17th at midnight, we will fail, our fortunes will fail, and our sacrifice will be meaningless. The Fongan cannot allow this to happen. Wee Ming must be found.
Glass asks if Hannah has ever heard of the Fongans, but she hasn't. Probably just one of many secretive aristocratic groups. Jin's voice plays on the recording, saying that Lam has found that Wee Ming has been meeting with someone named Madame Chen. The recording of Jin mocks Hannah over the possibility of Wee Ming seeing her, and that Hannah knows where she can be found. Madame Chen is something from Hannah's past, and it's clearly a sore subject. Hannah says she believes Weiming may be in a town called Shanxi, up the Hansik River, where Madame Chen has a restaurant. The conversation is interrupted when a car tries to ram them off the road. They end up going off a bridge and into water. But they all get out safely onto a boat. That's where the first disc ends. That was a good start, established the futuristic setting and got me used to how the multiple playable characters taking turns running about the same setting works. Leaving Deke out and just having me with two characters to start with stops it feeling too complex or overwhelming to begin with. Disc 2 goes in, and because this is a PS1 game with a female protagonist only 4 years after Tomb Raider, the second chapter starts on a shower scene. Meanwhile, the boat everyone climbed on is going up the river. Hannah only gets the chance to put a towel on before it all starts kicking off. They pass a small fishing village which is up in flames. Glass accuses Hannah of withholding information and asks why Weiming is so important when Deke sees her on a pier. Glass and Deke head off ahead while Hannah goes to get dressed, but even the enemy are aware of the year this game came out and she stopped when a demon with a machete jumps out at her. Start of a new chapter means my equipment has been whittled down to the basic single pistol and knife again. I shoot them down while they inch towards me and have Hannah run along the pier to run into two more. To save ammo, I crouch and keep swinging my knife, interrupting their attacks with my own most of the time, but still taking a few hits. It takes quite a few swings to kill one though. Then there was a seemingly dead one to the right that gets up and comes to me. Even with the pistol, it takes many shots to bring one down. Once they're all taken out, Hannah hides in a nearby house while Glass and Deke continue to chase Weiming. Glass gets ahead while I play as Deke for the first time. I run along the pier and turn right, entering the first door on this building. Deke has a breather when a big guy smashes through the door and tries to attack him, but Deke shoots him first. He falls over, dropping a flaming paper doll and telling Deke he has no idea what he's fighting. Deke responds by blowing his brains out. That's when he gets surrounded by demons. Welcome to one of the most awkward firefights you've ever seen. Somehow I come out on top, but only barely. While Deke checks out one of his kills, Glass is still chasing Weiming. He turns a corner and the pier ahead is on fire, and his way back is unblocked when a flaming palm tree falls on it. I get the chance to save here, which is good as I'm gonna be here a while. I run along to the bridge and, like the electrical grid and the hot pipes before it, the fire appears and disappears on this bridge in a pan. It's a bit tough being so precise with tank controls, and I lose a chunk of health by the time I reach the next screen. The bridge is surrounded by demons who can't climb up, so I'm still stuck crossing. The pan tricks me by having the fire at the end disappear and then burst back up immediately. The resulting death scene is a little funny though. It's like Glass willingly casually walked into fire and was then surprised to see himself up in flames. I get past it next time with very little health remaining. Glass walks along the pier and sees some men with guns across the river. Back with Hannah, the demons have overtaken their boat completely, and now I'm stuck in this corner with a large wave of them coming for me. Taking out all five of them uses up so many bullets. I get moving forward once they're all gone, past this shack to the screen where Deke and Glass split up. I go the opposite way to just find a couple more demons. I then go over where Deke went and into the house to get attacked by two more demons. I try to bait the sleeping one to kill it easily, but he gets a hit in and finishes me off. No save yet, so back to trying to stop Glass from setting himself alight. Next try I kill them all, only to find the room is empty otherwise. I kill another demon outside and then wary of the sleeping one. I try to slowly approach, but the camera angle changes and he sneaks up at that point and kills me. Then Glass combusts again. I take out the demon that killed me next time for the ones from the right route to reach me. I inspect the second room of this house only to get smacked to death in seconds. Glass burns again. Then I reach that second room and die again. Then I decide, screw those rooms and just run past them, heading towards this house in the back. Two demons in here and I kill them, one dropping a poor monkey. The back of the house is on fire and I leave the way I came and go back up the left path at the fork. I end up in front of this locked door and use the poor monkey to get inside, finally granting me a spot to save. The demons in here don't attack me and I walk to the back to find an old woman. She tells Hannah she needs to wash off any blood, as it was the blood that turned the people of the village into this. Hannah asks who caused this. The woman says that the day before, a fishing child fell into the rocks and sliced his leg open. He would have died had he not been found by Weiming, who carried him back while covered in his blood. Everyone ran to thank her, but then it all started. The old woman tried to escape on the military train that passes through once a week to gather rice, but since the military fear the demons, they shoot anyone who approaches the train. She says that Weiming is to blame for all this and Hannah asks if she knows where to find her. She does not. The demon in front of her gets up but I take him out. I find a second pistol in the corner and leave the old woman behind as I go through the back door. The military are right outside and could have heard everything they were saying. I stealth kill the two of them and go right back to save. There's a train station at the back but I run the other way along the tracks first. At the front of the train there's a spot to save and past it I take out the soldiers in front of a small group of houses. As I approach them, it looks like they're on fire, with more soldiers on patrol, making it unclear how much the fire was caused by the demons or by the military trying to contain it. I take out the soldier by the end houses and the one demon here, clearing out the area in preparation for later. I then backtrack and run up the train station. There are three soldiers patrolling here, but two of them are in line, meaning stealth killing one tends to alert the other, resulting in another death. Second time, I just try the dual pistols, but I don't even get one kill. What follows is several almost identical deaths. After 11 attempts at trying to fight these guys and failing, I try a different approach. I pretend to be Sonic. I have Hannah dodge roll forward and past all the soldiers, hoping the invincibility frames will keep me safe from their bullets. It actually works, and I dodge roll my way into a cutscene. A soldier sneaks up on Hannah from behind and holds her up. I have to go into my inventory to use the wet towel, making Hannah expose herself to the soldier, who is all awooga awooga just long enough for Deke to snap his neck from behind. After a couple jokes, Hannah fills Deke in on what she's learned. Deke decides to check out the train, but not before asking Hannah what the paper doll is about, which she dismisses as superstition, explaining that burning the dolls will send whatever the doll represents to the dead person it was burned for while they await judgment in hell. Hannah comments she's never seen them used in this kind of situation before. She says she'll check out the front of the train and sends Deke ahead while she robs the dead soldier of his uniform. Playing as Deke again, right away I have some soldiers to sneak up on. Deke's melee weapon is a pair of brass knuckles, which as far as I know, none of the melee weapons have any gameplay differences. His default gun is the shot pistol, of which I have two. They're more powerful than pistols, but hold less ammo before needing to reload. A pair of them will kill a soldier in two shots. I head to the ramp where there are two more soldiers and kill the first. But the spot I'm standing in is awkward and won't let me hit the other, so I die. This means having to repeat my spin dash as Hannah. Instead of going towards the ramp, I go into this corner to kill a soldier for an assault rifle. It's also where I can save. With it, I quickly kill the soldiers up the ramp and two more to the right side of the train. I check around the left side and promptly get shot to death by the three soldiers there. I try dodge rolls with the dual shot pistols next time, but they still get me. Next time I just run in there with the assault rifle and barely take them all down. I run further back and enter the open train car. A soldier comes up from behind and shuts the door behind him, trapping me in a boss battle with this bloke with a machine gun with just a box separating us. I hide around the boxes at the front of the screen and wait for him to come out so I can roll out and shoot. Thing is, you have to be really fast after he's done shooting as he'll go back into hiding almost immediately. And it can't be done too early after the dodge roll or you'll shoot the explosive box and take yourself out like I did first time. And the second time. And then I didn't even make it back to the train next time. Then he shot me down, and then the barrel again. On my sixth attempt I get it, but it takes a while. I slowly plink away tiny bits of his health in the second he's standing up after running out of ammo. Once he's low on health, I just stand in the open and fill him with rifle fire while he's coming out to finish him off. He's killed and the train door is shot open. I can take his Mark V assault rifle and go out the door to find the soldiers have filled the place back up again. This new rifle is quite good though, so I take them out easily and claim a labour access card. I head over to the left to this ladder control panel and use said card. I have two fuses in here to move around. I move them into the middle column under power and lock free. Turning the power back on unlocks the ladder. I then move them under power and ladder in the left column to make the ladder lower. I go up the ladder where I can save. I walk along the ceiling grid and soon get attacked by a new kind of demon with hook hands, telling Deke that Wee Ming belongs to them. They're fast movers and can jump off screen and drop down elsewhere to try and run in and cut you. I take them all out and get back to moving along the ceiling. This screen in particular is an issue, as the angle makes it so hard to tell what is girder and what isn't, making it very easy to just walk off the edge for an instant death. So next time I try a different path, walking along this much clearer screen and taking out many more hook hands on the way. Once I've killed all of them, one more drops down and Deke kills that one too. The way it dies, just bursting into flames and burning into nothing in seconds, leaves Deke with questions. Meanwhile, Glass catches up to Wee Ming while she works out he's a mercenary. She asks Glass what she's worth, to which he replies 90 million in cash and not being killed. She's not willing to cooperate though, saying Lam has been hiding a massive truth from her entire life, and only meeting Madame Chen will let her change her destiny. She can't let anyone interfere with that. Glass doesn't care, as he feels very strongly about not being killed by triads. She apologises for the mess here, saying she didn't know blood was the catalyst and that she only wanted to help that kid. She says she isn't evil, but has the power to release evil in others. Before Glass can take her, more demons show up and Wee Ming makes her escape. I have three demons I have to kill out here, and then it's back to clearing out the houses where there's three more. Once they're all dead, we swap back to Hannah. She's back at the save point in front of the train. There's two soldiers nearby, and running back to the nearby houses, one more soldier to get rid of along with some demons. There's two more back near the old woman's house. She's still there quivering, we can't help her. I run through the front door and return to the house I've cleared out a few times now, where there are now hook hand demons to deal with and several more machete demons. I next return to the house where I found the poor monkey and have to face both kinds of demons at once. I run out of assault rifle ammo and the dual pistols aren't enough to deal with the volume of attackers, so I die again. Next time I conserve that ammo and blow them all away, one of them dropping the she monkey. Time to backtrack all the way to the end house past the train and use said key to get inside. There's a single soldier and a wave of hook hands to kill in this very cramped space. The soldier drops the train key and I just barely take out all the hook hands as I run out of rifle ammo. Thankfully they dropped a lot more around the house. I return to the train and use the key to get inside. In the back of the room is a letter saying to deliver a foreign weapon for an 8 grand payout. But more important is the number in the top left. I have to put that number in the panel at the front of the train. 4N2B422C8000. After putting it in, Deke shows up. She asks if he's seen glass, but before they can decide whether or not to wait for him, they come under fire from above. Deke goes to deal with them while Hannah gets the train moving. Aiming on top of the train is a bit dodgy though, and so first time I die before I can kill either of the soldiers here, showing Deke falling off the train and getting crushed under the wheels. Next time I make sure to equip the dual guns to take them both out much easier. But even then, I only kill one with the second taking me out. Third time I kill them both, but the train is actually narrower than it looks, and so Deke falls off again when I try to pick up the ammo. Fourth time I kill them both and just stay in the middle. Glass runs up behind the train and yells at Hannah that the bridge ahead is out. No time to brake, Hannah just jumps out. Deke sees his situation and I have to run against the train as fast as I can. I must have reacted just a little too late as the explosions catch up to Deke and he falls with the train. Next time I make it a tiny bit further and Deke manages to jump off in time while the train is annihilated. Hannah checks on him while he complains that the train and its contents may have been worth more than Wee Ming. Glass says a train can still be useful and goes ahead while Hannah looks after Deke. He jumps down onto the floating burning remains. I can save and get running along the carriages. The military have got here too, so I have to deal with those as well. I reach the other side of the bridge and get back on land. I find a jeep and two soldiers, who I gun down quickly. But then a third joins in from behind and kills me with a shotgun blast of a dick when I turn around. But next time I'm ready for him, along with a fourth and fifth coming from the same side. However, a sixth one finishes me off just as I take out the fifth. I kill the sixth next try, but there's a seventh and eighth to bring me down instead. Fourth time I try stealth, but I don't kill one of them that time. And on my fifth try, the fifth soldier shoots my arsehole clean off. On my ninth try, I get it. Before alerting anyone, I dodge roll to the bottom right corner of the screen. From there, I have access to all the soldiers that appear without having to waste time turning precisely. I barely take damage and can wipe most of them out while they're still running on screen. One of them drops a truck key, and I use it to take the jeep. Turns out Wee Ming is in here. She demands they take her to Shanxi, and says that after they've seen Madame Chen, she'll let the three do what they want with her. Glass asks her who she is and how all this could even happen, to which Wee Ming says that she hopes Madame Chen can tell her. But we won't be finding out this episode. We're exactly halfway through the game and have finished the second disc, which is a good place to leave it for now. Disc 2 has a good atmosphere as well, with the village feeling very cramped and more claustrophobic with how often you can get crammed in small places with loads of demons. I will say that I found it had more frustrating moments than Disc 1 had, getting Hannah into the train station and that last bit came to mind. Plus the dodgy detection with Deke on the girders and the train. But then with all three characters, I think they still managed to balance it well with all the moving about and character swapping. So far, I was having an overall good time though. Despite my complaints, the setting, atmosphere and the mystery about what is going on with Wee Ming had me going. I even started getting used to the tank controls. It's so strange having seen someone play a lot of this game, but having no memory to the point that coming back is basically a completely new experience to me. But of course, there are two more discs. So we'll see if the goodwill the first two have built up will last the rest of the game or not. Time for the other half of Fear Effect. Last time I covered the first two discs and now I have two more to do. Last time we found the missing Wee Ming and agreed to take her to Madame Chen before handing her back to her father for the ransom money. Disc 3 starts with us pulling up outside Madame Chen's restaurant. Hannah says how she wished she'd never see this place again. Glass says he'll take Wee Ming in first and for Hannah and Deke to cover him. Hannah wants to go in with him, but Glass doesn't want to risk Madame Chen recognising her. He also makes sure Wee Ming will stick to her end of the deal and leave with them once she's done here. Deke asks Hannah about what happened back at the fishing village and if the answer is inside the restaurant. But Hannah replies that only pain and despair is inside that building. Inside, the two very quickly meet Madame Chen, and it turns out that Mr. Lam is here too, waiting for them. Madame Chen's bodyguards knock Glass out and chuck him into a storage room. I walk to the back of the room and pick up some cooking oil. Next to it is a cooking pot I smash on the floor to alert the guard outside. I pour the cooking oil in this drain hole, which was the wrong space, before the guy comes in. Since I had all my weapons confiscated, he easily kills me. Next time I pour the cooking oil in the top middle spot, the part that doesn't have a drain. I tried to bait the guard into walking into the oil, but he still managed to get a few shots on me first. But he eventually runs onto that spot, slips on the oil, and I assume breaks his neck, letting Glass take his gun. I also regain my smackjack. I go through the door and sneak down the corridor, clubbing another guard from behind. At the end, Glass peeks through the door to see Chen and Lam walking off with Wei Ming. The guards start moving tables out of the way and kicking customers out. Hannah and Deke are concerned, so Hannah will check through the front while Deke goes around the back. Deke ends up climbing over the roof and lands on the skylight. A couple searchlights will pan over the skylight, one of which revealing several cracked panels. I have to get across without standing on one of the cracked ones or it's a death. And different lights reveal different cracks, so you have a lot to memorize. Step on the wrong one and you'll get to see Deke fall through when it breaks. I get through it next time and they put the save on the opposite side, meaning I had to replay Glass's storage room adventure to have another go. I enter the door and Deke sneaks on inside while we go back to Glass. I walk through the door into the kitchen and instantly alert everyone, getting Glass gunned down in seconds. This time I crouch walk inside. I have to memorize their patterns to find the right timing to get through unseen. After one pair talk to each other and a second pair throw a tomato between themselves, that's my chance to sneak through and reach the second screen. Just one chef here, his pan is to stamp on a bug, do 3 chops, stamp on 2 bugs, then chop twice. I need to walk behind him while he's chopping to reach the third screen. 2 chefs here, I have to get past while one of them isn't turning around to spit or throw something, but I mess it up and get caught again. I get past them next time and reach the fire alarm. I press it to set off the sprinklers and make more staff flee, but a couple guards stay behind, which I'm not prepared for. No time to equip a weapon, so I run off around the corner where the enemies in the next room kill me. Next time I'm prepared and have 2 pistols equipped to wipe them out as soon as they appear on screen. But I run out of bullets with 1 left, and he gets a lot of free shots on me as I swap to the smackjack. We end up double killing each other. For whatever reason, they actually both die next time. There's another off to the left and shooting at him has me hit a pan of boiling oil and splash it onto him to take him out. He drops a shotgun, and I go into the room to the left so I can save. I go into the main lobby where I ran before and gun everyone down. Then I end up going in circles for a bit. I'm supposed to go in the back corner of the lobby to reach the front door and open it to let Hannah in. Glass fills her in on what happened and suggests that they just quit and leave as all this is no longer worth it. But Hannah says that they can't just abandon Wei Ming. Glass tells her that there's no way they're getting any money out of Lam now, but for Hannah, it's no longer about the money. It's all but stated that the girls are kept as sex slaves in the back, and Hannah implies that she was once one of them. Glass gives her 10 minutes before he's gone, and tells her to check upstairs. During that conversation, rooms identified as Glass have been refilled with more guards, but Hannah gets to keep the weapon she found in the fishing village to make things easier. I return to the room where I last saved as Glass and head towards the front of the screen. Now, I don't know how others feel about the sex slave aspect of Hannah's past and how it was handled, but there is one thing I feel was a big misstep. Hannah has to dress as one of the slaves to get upstairs. That in itself is not the thing I take issue with, but they included the sexy silhouette strip with the music and the dancing and the camera angles, which considering her history with this place is just weird and poorly thought out. I pointed out the moments on disc 2, but in those cases I was mainly just teasing and poking fun at how that was everywhere at the time, and a lot of it feels desperately silly looking back. But this choice I felt was a genuine mistake. One moment they could definitely improve in that remake if it ever comes out. All they have to do is not try and make that moment look sexy. More guards outside and I shoot them to shit. Yet somehow the guy manning this door to the back didn't hear it, just sees how Hannah is dressed and lets her through. Also a funny little glitch where the screen changes, but Hannah stays in the same spot, then snaps to the bottom of the stairs. Guards here don't actually attack Hannah in these clothes unless you make her pull out a weapon. I never really considered that. I just saw enemies and instinctively thought kill. I go up the stairs and around the corner to be told to get back to work. But because I still had my knife out, he starts shooting me right after the cutscene ends. This results in another death. I'll admit I didn't realise what was going on while playing and thought this section wasn't designed very well. This is why I tried to have a gap of at least 1 month between recording and writing the video, as it lets me look at the whole thing more calmly and let me notice things that are definitely my fault. Next time I blow them away with the assault rifle and get Hannah a shotgun. I head down the hall to the right and then around the corner at the end, going through the red door on this screen. I can save in here and then back outside I have even more guards to deal with. I move down the hall to the next screen and go through the red door there. Deke holds Hannah up until she turns around and he realises who she is. Hannah tells him what he missed and he reaches the same conclusion as Glass. Leave it and run off while they're still alive. But once again, Hannah won't leave Wei Ming, To which Deke questions if this is even still business anymore, to which Hannah admits it isn't. A guard barges in and Hannah pretends to have come to the wrong room by mistake. She's marched out, leaving me in control of Deke. I leave and continue the path down the hall I was taking as Hannah. In the right door is a dressing room. There's a guard to kill but nothing else, so I go back the way I came. I go into the room opposite the stairs Hannah climbed up. There's a coin on the nightstand that I can take. I then go all the way back to the room I saved in. There's a jukebox next to the bed and I use the coin on it. There are 5 buttons to press and I had to look up the solution because I had no idea. Bottom right, middle left, top right, middle right, bottom left. The puppet mimics the movements in the order I press them on the buttons and the machine moves aside to reveal a hidden passage. It leads to a much darker room, which I then lead through the door. I end up in a much fancier room with a few more doors, including this big red one with a plinth on either side. Instead I go through the double doors opposite that one and take out 2 more guards. This room has a bed and a place to save. Back in the last room I go right into a hallway, taking out a guard on the way to this lift at the end that I can't use. Instead I go through the door to the right of the hallway. Another guard to kill and the elevator key to take. I return to the lift and ride it down. I get out and go into the room opposite it. I grab a wrench in here and then go down the stairs next to the lift. Another corridor and 2 more guards to kill, but my stealth kill fails and I alert them both, leading to a death. Next time I just gun them both down. The room is full of pipes blasting out steam that will damage me. I have to avoid it and reach the pipes in the back, then use the wrench on them, which turns off the steam and gets a fountain going back in the area above. It also lets me grab the Madam Room key. I take the lift back up and clear out that area of its new guards. I save by the bed just in time to get killed right as I step back out of that room. It takes until my 3rd attempt to kill the 3 guards waiting for me. I use the Madam Room key on the big red door and go inside. Deke is unaware that Madam Chen is behind the door as she starts to transform off camera. The last thing we see is Deke's face before she attacks and the screen cuts to black. Meanwhile, Glass is being chased by more guards. I run around the corner while trying to equip a gun and take a lot of damage. I kill one, but the others ignore me as I go through the green door and kill the guard in this corridor. I run back through the kitchen, which is now on fire, to save in the changing room. With no one guarding the door leading upstairs, I go up and fight my way through the floor to the upstairs dressing room, where I run out of bullets just in time to get killed. That was the wrong place anyway. That's because I went the wrong way, I needed to go left past the stairs. There's a locked door here, so I go around the corner where I can save in the middle of the corridor. Good thing too, because I take a few steps forward and get shot dead. I kill the guy next time and he drops the lounge key, which I use on the door I passed. I go inside and almost instantly get killed. I last saved at just a single hit from death. I get them both next time and head to the back of the room and go through the door there to end up in another corridor. That was the wrong door. So I go back once I realise a couple minutes later and go through the door to the right of the one I first entered from. Inside is one of the slaves, begging not to be harmed, making Glass realise Hannah's connection to this place. He tells her to escape before she gets hurt, but there was a guard under the bed who starts shooting at him. For this fight I have to avoid shooting the woman. The guard comes out from certain spots under the bed in a pattern, but instead I find myself rolling in place in the corner and waiting for him to pop out in front of me so I can shoot him. You know when you fit him because there's a small cutscene showing it. First time I only hit him once before he kills me. It's not until my 3rd attempt that I put him down. Just in case you thought Glass was coming across a little too kind, he threatens to kill the woman if he sees her again before she runs out. But like Deke, Glass too falls victim to the whole hiding against the wall while you enter the room trick, as Mr. Lam comes in with a machete and cuts his arm off. Glass passes out while Lam mocks him, and we cut back to Hannah. I start next to the dressing room and there's finally something in here for me, a white vase that I take. I return to the room I found the coin as Deke and kill the guard there to make him drop another lounge key. I go back inside to find it filled with slaves as Hannah asks if any of them have seen Wei Ming. None of them have an answer for her, so she instead has them flee, but without the threat of killing them like with Glass. I go through the wrong door I went through as Glass and follow that corridor all the way to find his fountain. I pull a daisy out from it. I go back and 2 more guards appear, one of them dropping an office key when killed. I return to the lounge and use that key on the door next to the one I returned from. There's a lift in here and I ride it up. The corridor it takes me to leads back to the area I last saw Deke. I take out the guard in front of the Madam door and return to the save room. In here I can grab a black vase from the top of the wardrobe. I return to the Madam room and place the white vase on the left and black vase on the right. I next have to choose a flower for each vase. Fresh sunflower for the white vase and wilted calla lily for the black vase. This lets me in to see Madam Chen, holding up Deke's corpse. Chen recognises Hannah, calling her by her birth name, Mei Yun, in an attempt to reassert control over her. Hannah rejects the name and demands to know where Wei Ming is, to which Chen says she has left with her father. Wei Ming has learned the truth about herself, and that Mr. Lam has used a pact with Yim Lao Wong to gain the wealth and power he has. Hannah says that she isn't afraid of Madame Chen, who responds by skinning herself alive to reveal a demonic form. She throws Deke's corpse from the balcony as he lands in the lobby below, impaling his eye socket on a spike. The resulting blood splatter hits Wei Ming, and we see exactly what happened at the fishing village when her powers are triggered against her will, transforming everyone nearby into a demon, including the recently saved slaves who were trying to escape. Hannah responds to all this by leaving Chen's room. They enter the save room only to be attacked by two of the demonified slaves. They're more fragile than the guards and easier to deal with, so despite the stakes being higher, the demons replacing the guards actually makes things easier. I start backtracking to the kitchen. I get a cutscene on the way in the lounge of demons breaking in through the window. Even with them being easier to fight, there's still a huge amount of them pouring into this room, so they wear me down and kill me. Once again, I take them all down on the second try. I make my way back to the kitchen in time to see Wei Ming fleeing a group of demons by locking herself in the freezer. In here she finds glass, hanging from a meat hook, but still alive. Through the missing arm and the impalement and the freezing, he tries to joke with Wei Ming about offering a discount on her rescue if she helps him down. Wei Ming gets a cloth to bandage his bleeding stump, as Glass asks if this is the work of Satan. She tells him not the devil, but Yim Lao Wong, the King of Hell. The belief is that when one dies, they have to wait in hell for their audience with Yim Lao Wong, and they could be waiting years or even decades for that moment. This also explains the part about burning offerings that Hannah taught them about back in the fishing village. But the group mentioned back near the start, the Fongens, have managed to make a pact with Yim Lao Wong in that paper offerings that should only make things real in hell are being made real in the living world. This is a method Lam used to build up his wealth. Create an offering that should send money to hell, instead creates money on Earth. But Glass asks what Yim Lao Wong gets out of this deal, and the answer is Wei Ming herself. This would happen in the last hour of her 18th year, which she suspected for a long time. She wasn't trying to run away, she was trying to get to hell before that time to prevent what would happen if she didn't. At this point, Glass is unresponsive. I get control of Hannah and have her fight through the kitchen and back to the changing room. There's a demon behind me and she kills me while I try to turn around. I take her out next time to grab the meat locker key and have Hannah change back into her normal clothes. I take out more demons and enter the meat locker. This is where Hannah discovers the mutilated hanging glass. She hears a noise nearby and I find a shotgun in here. I turn around the corner to find a door. The noise was a spinning saw, and Madame Chen is here too. She praises Hannah's guts in coming back here, but then asks if it actually is courage or just a lack of emotion, wondering if that's how she's managed to kill so many people. She uses that to try and shame her for her escape, as we learn more about Hannah's earlier claim that Jin helped her get off the streets. Back when Hannah was a slave here, Jin helped her escape, and Chen accuses her of sleeping her way to freedom. Hannah neither confirms nor denies, because she doesn't even acknowledge the accusation. The attempt at shaming her isn't going to work. Wei Ming hides behind Hannah, and the boss fight starts. I have to keep Wei Ming alive and deal with demons as I approach Chen. Killing demons has them drop a paper Madame Chen doll. I have to use the dolls on the ring of fire keeping me away from her to get rid of it and turn her to her human form, allowing me to shoot her. She turns back and another demon drops down, and since the shotgun is so good, I wipe her out and burn another doll for another hit right away. It takes one more shot to defeat her. One of the more satisfying villains to take down recently thanks to everything she's done during the game and before. Chen takes a bullet in the gut and collapses, returning to her demon form. She says Hannah has no idea the kind of hell that is coming for the world once Wei Ming reaches her full potential. She calls Hannah by her birth name one more time, only for her to assert that her name is Hannah before she cuts her up with the circular saw. Chen's death opens up a portal to hell. Wei Ming tells Hannah that this is a one-way trip, but Hannah says that she may as well see it through at this point. They descend into hell and Disc 3 ends. That was much better than Disc 2. Less frustrating moments and a lot of plot progression. The part I complained about earlier was my only major flaw, and that was a few seconds long. I was certainly not expecting the amount of bodily harm seen committed on the main characters. It deals with heavy subject matter though, so I understand if it's too much for some people. But I feel considering the time the game was released, it could have ended up a lot more thoughtless and faux-edgy. Disc 4 goes in and Hannah asks why Wei Ming suspected Madame Chen was involved. She says that Chen knew her father, and once she found out how his wealth was amassed, she assumed Chen was after more than just money. Hannah comments that everyone wants something that Yim Lao Wong can offer, but wonders why Wei Ming is so important. Wei Ming herself still doesn't have all the details yet. She says she can feel the dangers all around them, and how they desire to reach her. Hannah says they'll stay close, but that just encourages bad luck, as the floor crumbles beneath Wei Ming, dropping her in the water while Hannah has to watch her get dragged under. That's when I gain control. This first screen has platforms rising from the water and dropping. I have to figure out the correct pattern to cross. I fuck up very quickly and have to watch Hannah also fall in the water and get dragged under. It takes me quite the amount of tries to get this right. It takes until my 8th try. First I step on the platform to the left and then the one below it. I then wait. Then the next three I just have to be quick and run across right as they pop up to have the time to reach the other end. I then have a few empty screens to run over, to take in the atmosphere of hell. Eventually I reach a screen containing some huts, where I meet a new kind of enemy, ghosts. I keep shooting them as they slowly float towards me until they fade away. Instead of dropping ammo, they leave behind paper ammo, and I can't reload my guns with paper. I enter the middle hut to take on another ghost, and the right hut has a spot to save so I never have to run across those platforms again. I move on right from the huts passing this huge candle thing, heading towards a screen on this screen with a door, across the two screens that make up this bridge to one with another candle. I keep heading away from the screen to reach this turn, with three more ghosts to deal with and another two that come from behind afterwards. One of them leaves behind a paper gate key. With it I backtrack all the way to the huts and instead go left. Lightning strikes on this area and creates a fire. I can burn all my paper ammo on this fire to turn it into real ammo, along with the gate key I just got to burn to open a red door elsewhere. Once you burn your first offerings, the hook hand demons start to appear again and they are a nightmare, easily killing me. They're also a problem in that they take much more ammo to kill than they drop, or at least they do on hard difficulty. The first group soaks up all the machine pistol ammo I built up before now. They've also repopulated areas I'd already cleared out as well, like the huts. They soured me on the offering mechanic. I was fine with it and thought it was pretty cool and added to the atmosphere when it was just ghosts. But now I pretty much need to backtrack to the fire nearly every screen because these guys are everywhere and leave me needing to restock after every encounter. By the fourth screen with a million hook hands, I'm already trying to ignore them and just run past them. I return to the screen where I found the gate key and keep along that path to find the gate I burned open. It leads to a prison. As I move along this prison I can pick up a paper assault rifle. In the back is the soul of Madame Chen. She tries to blame Hannah for her situation, but it doesn't work. She does say that she can help Hannah though. She says Hannah may have already seen her daughter wandering around here and gives Hannah a doll to take to her. She says her daughter is lonely and that she can't reach her. If Hannah takes her the doll, Chen will help her in return. She really got over being caught up with that saw quickly, didn't she? As I go back the way I came, I am so happy to see a ghost instead of hook hands. Of course one of those drops down seconds later. Screw them, I just keep running towards the screen and then away on the next one. Eventually I reach this doorway to a little cave I can see a child run into. There's also a spot to save, which I'm thankful for. I enter the cave to find a playroom full of toys and the girl crying in a corner. I give the kid the doll and she turns around to reveal herself as Hannah back when she was the child. Kid Hannah asks if she even remembers how happy she was at this age, before her parents died and she was left with just the doll. She says that as much as Hannah had tried to run from her past, she can't run from her and she has a secret that can help. She says that Hannah still knows it too, unless she's too afraid to find it. She asks Hannah if she ever misses being Mei Yun, to which she admits that she does. The kid then gives her a hint. As a child, we flowered like a branch under the rain. Most likely a coincidence, but it works as a bit of foreshadowing for the second game. Next to her is a weird clock with the numbers 0, 5, 18, 35 and 88 on it. Underneath is 5 sets of bars, each one ascending from 1 bar to 5. I place 5 bars under the number 5 and confirm, then 1 bar under the 5 and confirm. Kid Hannah is replaced with her model from Disc 3, meant to represent Hannah at 18. This one says, "In youth, our beauty attracted the desire of many men." So back to the clock, I put 2 bars under the 18 and follow it up with 5 bars. This swaps her out again with an older Hannah at 35 years old. She says, "In adulthood, we marry and give birth to many children." 1 bar under 35, followed by 5 bars. I admit I use the guide for this one. I get that the numbers match with Hannah's age, but not what the bars mean. One last Hannah, now at 88 years old. In death, our withered body crumbles into bone and dust. 4 bars under 88 and confirmed twice, then 3 bars, then 2. The old Hannah then tells her that the answer was inside her head, literally, as she decomposes and falls, skull cracking open to reveal the stone scroll that Hannah takes. She states that she isn't afraid, just the one last cheeky little fake out scare from her kid self. Now to return to Madame Chen. To conserve ammo and health, I dodge roll my way there past all the demons. I give Chen the stone scroll and she thanks Hannah for looking after her daughter with a gift, a tree branch. Hannah asserts that she is not Chen's daughter. Even in hell, Chen takes the chance to mock her past by reminding Hannah that she was once Chen's girl. Hannah rejects the usage of Mei Yun one last time by telling Chen that she killed Mei Yun. Chen tries to claim that none of what Hannah did under Chen was against her will, and then she just turns into a few ghosts that I have to kill. That's one way to deal with losing an argument, turn into a lot of ghosts. Although it seems ambiguous whether or not this is even the real soul of Madame Chen, these could be Hannah's own insecurities about her past manifesting to mess with her. The ghosts kill me though. Next time I just deal with all the demons on the way and burn myself some assault rifle to take the ghosts down much quicker with next time. I pick up the tree branch and take it back to the bonfire to burn. Off to the left, one of the candles has been lit, but there's one further past it that I can light with the lit tree branch. There's one right of the huts and across the bridge past the huts. Lighting all three of them will open up the door I've passed a few times between the huts and the bridge. I go through the door for Hannah to find an empty chair. Another ghost shows up, this one talking to Hannah. Hannah asks if he is Yim Lai Wong, and the ghost finds that idea hilarious. He says that who he is not important, but what he can do for Hannah. She asks him where Wei Ming is, to be told he'll find her when it is time for her to find her, along with Yim Lai Wong. He gives her another paper gate key and tells her to see his brother. He leaves, saying that they are preparing for a funeral, and leaves me to deal with more hook hands, one of which drops a stone tree half. This also restocks a few more screens with demons as I return to the bonfire and burn the paper gate key to make the real one appear in the left hut, so I go and get it. I next get dodge rolling past the cave leading to the player room to find a big fancy gate. I have to kill the hook hands here as trying to cycle to the key and unlock the door before they hit me wasn't working. Hannah goes through the gate which closes behind her. Meanwhile, Glass isn't dead. He wakes up and pulls himself off that hook, finding a gun nearby. He finds the stairs into hell and climbs in himself. He sees the platforms Hannah had to deal with and decides, nah, and tries a different path. He climbs down this hole, which closes behind him. Of course, with only one hand, dual-wielding weapons is not an option anymore. I follow the tunnel to find a dragon statue in the wall and a fork, which I turn left at. It leads to a bleeding door I can go through. I have ghosts to fight and just a single crappy pistol or smackjack to fight them with. I can use a torch next to the door to burn my paper ammo. Through the door I have demon dogs to fight while they skid around the floor and get caught on the room's collision. I then go through the next door to find a moon key and a paper machine pistol. I return to the fork and take the right turn from the entrance, using the moon key to unlock the door at the end. A ghost can be seen walking away and whispering Glass's name. There's a door to the left, but I instead follow that ghost towards the screen. This results in Glass running back around while chased by ghosts. I take them out and try going around the corner again, taking out more ghosts. There's a red dragon statue I can interact with here. It says its name, which I couldn't fully make out thanks to the distortion and the lack of subtitles, but I did hear that it is the Dragon of Fire. Past it is some vines and a much needed safe spot, because I'm going to be here a while. I climb down the pit where I can get a closer look at the ghost, who has a familiar, horrific facial wound. He walks off screen, but I get killed by the demon dogs. They are simply too fast for me and I don't have enough health to kill them first. I try running past them, it doesn't work because there's Nightmite to pick up down here. I try a lot of dodge rolling and even manage to kill one at the exact same time the other kills me. It takes me just under half an hour to work it out. First I slowly back away while the other one gets caught on the geometry and manage to kill that. Then a million dodge rolls waiting for that 1 free second I have to shoot the other and eventually take that one down as well. There are two dragon statues down here, the Dragon of Earth and Dragon of Heaven, with the Sun Key floating between them. I leave the pit and go to that door I just skipped, unlocking it with the Sun Key. There's ghosts to kill, but they get me first. Once again I have too little health to survive against them. On my 7th or so try, I dodge roll into the corner and just stay there until I can shoot. I finally take them out and can grab a paper assault rifle. I also interact with the Dragon of Mountain statue. I return to the pit I found the Sun Key in and climb up the other side. The ghost watches me climb and walks off. I follow him to reach his cracked, pulsating floor and have to deal with a load of ghost enemies. I do quite well for a first try, only dying as I deal the killing shot to the second to last one. I deal with them all next time and can cross to the other side of the floor. There's another dragon statue here, the Dragon of Water, and a spot to save before I climb down into another pit. There's a mirror here which shows a series of images corresponding to the elements all the dragons represent. I run down the tunnel nearby and get a dick move when the camera changes and I can't react in time to evolve running onto this tile, resulting in Glass falling through to his doom. There's two paths along these tiles, first the one leading to some ammo, and then the one that lets me get across. The markings on the tiles correspond to the symbols underneath the dragon statues, crossing in the order they showed up in the mirror. At the other end I can grab a stone sword. Once I turn back, the fake tiles have fallen and there's a trio of ghosts on the other side. Now to backtrack pretty much to the start of this section. The room's restocked on enemies once again. This includes the pit I was stuck in earlier with one more enemy than last time, but this time I can actually just roll past them. The ghost is eyeing me once again as I climb up. I see him once again by the very first dragon statue I saw, one I couldn't interact with before. I use a stone sword here to blow up that wall to reveal another tunnel. I can save and I follow the tunnel to the end where Glass discovers that the ghost he's been following is Deke. Deke says that the demon Glass is seeing was created from Deke's actions in life, every person he's killed. Deke says that when Glass dies and ends up here and sees what he'll become, he'll understand. Glass apologises, which makes Deke laugh. Glass was the one who brought the original deal to Deke and got him involved. He trusted Glass, but now he's going to make Glass be like him. Deke is the toughest boss in the game, I found. My arena is entirely platforms that rise and sink beneath the water in a set pattern as Deke moves over them. Of course, ending up in water or being touched by Deke as he travels over them is still an instant kill. So I'll just skip to my 6th attempt, the one where I succeed. I start with 3 platforms vertically and Deke sinks the lowest one, then the middle, top and middle again, then the lowest before emerging to give me the chance to shoot him. The damage results in him dropping 2 more platforms, one each on the left and right in the middle. Deke first takes the lowest, then the middle 3, the side and top platforms together, then all 3 middle platforms, the middle, right and top together, then he emerges for a shooting. He keeps repeating that pattern until I shoot him down to 2 bars of health. He drops 2 more platforms to the left and right bottom and gets rid of the previous left and right platforms along with the top one. He starts this phase by letting me get more shots in. Deke next takes out the entire bottom row, then does it again, then takes out the top platform before revealing himself for more bullets. Go for it one more time and I finish him off. The demon Deke falls over defeated and melts, leaving an orb behind as Glass vows revenge against those responsible for his death. He spies a bucket on a rope. It leads to the top of this well above him as we transition back to Hannah crossing through the gate. I walk down this path taking on more hug hands as I enter this mausoleum. There's another throne identical to the one from earlier, and the spirit's brother appears. Hannah shows him the stone tree half she received and the brother reveals a second half. He tells her that to grow the tree it must be in the light and dark. He disappears and leaves behind a crank. I leave, having another wave of hug hands on the way out, and deal with even more as I travel all the way back to the bonfire. Moving past the bonfire will take me to a well. I use the crank here and it turns out to be the same well Glass was under, him leaving the stone eye he got from Deke for Hannah to find. Once Hannah walks away, Glass also climbs out. I continue down the path as we get the scene that plays as an intro before you start up the game. There's a funeral procession for Wee Ming, which Wee Ming herself is made to march along to. Hannah sees it and tries to shout Wee Ming over to her. However, Glass sneaks up from behind and cuts her throat. When Hannah asks why he would do that, he points at himself and the state he is in. He brings up Deke's death and says that Wee Ming is the cause of it all. Glass just decided to end it. But Wee Ming gets up, saying that only she can end it. She repeats that she needs Hannah's help to return to hell. Glass aims at her, which leads to him and Hannah turning their guns on each other. Hannah says that if they don't help her, the world is over. Glass is having none of it though, and while they argue, Wee Ming is carted off again. Hannah runs after her while Glass is left surrounded by ghosts. I cannot kill this many, I just have to keep shooting until the next cutscene starts. Glass is held down as Mr. Lamb shows up just to mock him, by throwing his lost arm down at his feet. Back at Hannah, I continue down this path to reach a huge tree. I deal with another set of hook hands to approach this puzzle. I have all these tiles on this map and 4 items to place on them. The stone scroll goes on the topmost tile, the stone eye on the tile of the bucket, the left stone half on the leftmost tile, and the right stone half on the bottom right tile. The puzzle burns away and I'm told to put Disc 2 back in to continue to the final puzzle and the end of the game. Disc 4 has the best atmosphere in the game, with the creepy hell setting and things like the dragon puzzle and the demon Deke fight, but it's held back by combat being at its most frustrating thanks to the obnoxious hook hand spam. The paper offerings would have been a fun mechanic and once again helped out the atmosphere, but dealing with those enemies made me resent it in the end. Overall, I'd say Disc 3 was my favourite, Disc 4 comes close thanks to its atmosphere, then Disc 1 is the least flawed but lacks the highs of 3 and 4, with Disc 2 going last because one of them has to. It wasn't just the puzzle board that burned, everything around Hannah melts away to place her inside this large paper puzzle. I now have to find the correct spots to place those 4 items around here, actually 3 now, as the stone halves have now combined into a stone willow. This results in me just rubbing myself against everything and waiting for a use prompt to show up, then I cycle between all the items until one turns out to be correct. There's also a furnace to burn any offerings with, and once I start doing so, more hook hands get involved. Once I've cleared them all out, it's time to get placing. Stone eye goes here, Hannah places it and it explodes. And of course, several more hook hands drop down afterwards. This spot here is where the stone willow goes. Finally, the stone scroll goes here. Once again, the room disappears and Hannah finds herself in a new place with a familiar figure in a chair nearby. It's Jin, though he prefers to be referred to by his true name, Yim Lao Wong. He also returns to his true form. He explains his motivation. Hell is full. More and more people end up in hell faster than he can judge them. And then there's just no room to send their souls. Weeming is his solution. Those affected by her power are shown their true selves and transform as if they have already been sent to hell. Hannah realises she's been set up from the start, while Yim Lao Wong wonders why she never questioned why Weeming's power never affected her. Then she realises she was splashed with Jin's blood when he was shot out of a land building, the only antidote to Weeming's power. The whole time he was testing Hannah to see if she was capable of looking after Weeming, to ensure that she lived to the point she would complete her destiny. Hannah asks where she is, and she appears, along with Glass. Hannah points out that with Weeming already in hell at this time, his plan has failed. It turns out that this isn't quite truly hell yet. Weeming begs Hannah to help her continue the rest of the way to hell to stop the prophecy. At this point, we finally learn what Weeming is. Yim Lao Wong says he created her the same way he created her father's wealth, by burning a paper doll to have her created on Earth. I love the way Lam responds to Weeming's reaction, the little, "not my fault" shrug. Speaking of Lam, he has failed Yim Lao Wong, and so he slashes him open and gets his blood on Weeming, transforming him into a demon too. Glass takes the chance to grab Lam's gun and wants to kill all of them, but Hannah will not let him kill Weeming, as she believes her. And now I have to choose which character side I'm taking to determine the ending. First, I choose Hannah. She regrettably shoots Glass dead. Weeming tells Hannah to distract Yim Lao Wong while she gets away and runs. Yim Lao Wong sends the demon Lam on me. And this is Hannah's final boss. He spits lightning across the arena while flying demons come at me. If I stand in the far corners next to these torches, Lam can't hit me at all, only the flying demons can. So I focus on them, waiting for a piece of paper money to appear in the arena. I take it and burn it in one of the torches. This causes Lam great pain, and removes a third of his health. I next wait for a second piece of paper to appear and burn that, and a third to take him down. Lam is killed, while Weeming tells Hannah she still has a chance to change her life and hopes she doesn't meet Hannah again, disappearing into hell. Yim Lao Wong's not happy, screaming that Hannah has ruined everything, but Hannah shuts him up with a bullet to the head. She stands outside Madame Chen's burning restaurant, saying that now she has ruined everything. That's one ending. I reload my save and this time I take Glass's side. Glass shoots Hannah in the head, telling Weeming that while Hannah may have been fooled, he won't be. Weeming transforms into her own demonic form. Weeming constantly spawns demons out of her flesh. I need them out of the way so that I can hit Weeming. They still drop paper ammo and there are still torches if I need to reload. I get up close to Weeming so that after killing her demons, I can get quick hits in on her before she creates more. But first time, I'm not good at it, so I die. I get a bad ending. Glass falls down dead and the prophecy is fulfilled. Weeming is sent into the living world with her powers unleashed. Next time I do a lot better and slowly whittle down her health until she is done. She collapses and returns to her human form, dead. She then reverts into the paper doll Yim Lao Wong made her out of. The place collapses and Glass escapes. He too leaves Madame Chen's place after having killed whatever demons were left inside. He felt it was his way of doing right by Hannah and Deke. But he keeps hold of Weeming's doll, feeling with it he has many more new opportunities. Then there's the final middle option available if you played through on hard difficulty. Hannah manages to get through to Glass and he stands down. Yim Lao Wong sends Lam on Hannah and I get the exact same boss fight again, which I defeat in the same way. Weeming returns to hell, telling Hannah that she will repay her sacrifices and that she will never forget Hannah. Yim Lao Wong throws a shit fit and tries to slut shame Hannah for her past again, but Glass guns him down for insulting his friend. He falls into a void and explodes while everything collapses around them and they escape. So are all the dead waiting to be judged just stuck in a limbo now? They crawl out of the ruins of the restaurant, Weeming's gift being to restore Glass's severed arm and to revive Deke, who has no memory of dying. Deke asks how they made out on the deal, them all being alive and in one piece again being the best result they could ask for as they all walk off. While I had a few complaints, which you've heard throughout these two videos, I enjoyed this game. I will admit, gameplay is one of its weaker aspects, but it makes up for it in story and atmosphere. I was expecting a standard Resident Evil clone, so was expecting the land building to be the entire game setting. So I was pleasantly surprised to see each disc go for a different vibe, from cyberpunk to zombie apocalypse to business acting as a criminal front and then literal hell except not quite. The three protagonists were likeable enough, and there was a big chance they could have come across as selfish monsters or obnoxious tryhard dickheads who don't deserve anything. But Glass and especially Hannah have enough depth to avoid that. Deke kind of gets a short end in terms of story time and play time, but he's still fun. This game has a remake on the way, hopefully, and it does swap out the fixed camera and tank controls for a more modern third-person shooter style. Honestly, if they pull it off, I'm fine with that. Even if I got used to the tank controls, they are an acquired taste and I do not love them. As long as they keep the main story beats and especially that atmosphere, I think it could be in with a chance of being an improvement. Of course, the thing has been in development for a while, so it actually has to come out first before we can see. I'm looking forward to seeing where the series goes from here. I have memories of the second game, but as I've said, most are very vague, and I've never touched Sedna. It seems most hate it, but that doesn't necessarily mean I will. Hopefully, we will eventually see. But this one was good.